Please welcome Michael Peterson.
Thanks, everyone. For those who were here yesterday, there's going to be a few pieces of repeat, but I'm going to try to keep it mostly new so that it's, at least entertaining, hopefully. But yes, I'm talking about a project that I'm helping to run for the University of Saskatchewan Galleries. We have a number of our project team at a table here, a few others. We are the project with the canoe outside, so we will be getting to that just before lunch. We'll explain why that's here. So this project, it came out of a shift in focus with the University of Saskatchewan Galleries that took place back, well, we applied originally to the Digital Strategy Fund back in 2018. Because the galleries were looking at shifting from a focus on the galleries as a discrete physical space to one that was looking at how organizationally they could support galleries, artists, organizations throughout the province and really leverage those connections at the university in support of others. So out of that came really three key areas, building relationships with the broader Saskatchewan community, developing opportunities for cross-disciplinary outcomes connected to the arts, and a greater inclusion of Indigenous perspectives. So the first and third, we'll talk about more throughout the project, but I do want to really focus on that second one, this idea of cross-disciplinarity. So there's really, as we view it, three ways that, or at least three ways that we can view how art and other disciplines can work together. So the first, art and design as visual communication, it's looking more at visual language, visual tools, and I bring in design here as well because that's part of my background, and because both art and design are often subjugated to other disciplines when we're talking about the production of knowledge. So this area is the area that looks at things like, you know, how can we make a Bill Nye the Science Guy video more interesting? How can we create more engaging research posters? How can we present the knowledge that's developed in other subject matters through art to make it more palatable and interesting to a broader audience? It's useful and there's value in it, but it doesn't value artistic knowledge or design knowledge in particular. It's just using those to communicate other areas. The second area is looking at art and design as pedagogical tools. So respecting that there are unique ways of learning through art and design, but still using those to teach other subject matters. So as an example, one of the better examples I found, I bring in one of my colleagues, Kaylee Raber, who runs the Health and Design Lab at Emily Carr University. We did our master's together, and she developed a program called Teaching with Design that spent time in elementary school looking at how she could use design methods to teach other subject matters. So just as one example, the piece up here was a project for a grade six class where they had to build an eco-friendly home using renewable energy. And so they had to understand the different types of renewable energy, the different types of materials that would be used, and they learned through the process of building. And so she saw a lot of success with students who were having difficulty with reading and writing because this was using like visual and spatial cognition. At the same time though, it was still focused, while they were using design methods, still focused on the learning that came through other subject matters. So the last, and the one that we really wanted to focus on in this project is looking at how art and design produce unique knowledge. So within the craft world, I think of this as the way this produces embodied knowledge. So how do we learn through materials? So materials-based learning, learning through making, learning through your hands. What, you know, it's what knowledge is embodied there. There are overlaps too with design practice. I'll explain this a bit more. But it's looking at the areas on the right, which are tacit and latent knowledge. So the best explanation I've heard of this is when you're learning to ride a bicycle, once you've learned how to ride, you learn how to balance. You know how to do that, but if you were to explain every step along the way, when are you pressing down with your right hand, when are you pressing down with your left, when are you pedaling, it would be very hard to intellectualize that. we know it, but that knowledge is latent. It's held within our body and within our movement. And it was really when I started doing my master's, that was an area that really was new to me. It was this idea of acknowledging that knowledge and actually looking at how we can start to research that, how we can start to incorporate and give preference to that type of knowledge as opposed to just the type of knowledge that's kept in our brains and our mind. There's also parallels then to me with indigenous ways of knowing, with embodied learning, with land-based practices that again acknowledge that we're human, we're animal, we're not just brains and minds. Toward this then, we also brought in a design perspective, a perspective that looked at how we could use design methods to start to learn and then develop a product in response to our communities. So on that middle slide, we have some of our design, or on the middle of the slide, we have some of our design methods, and on the left side, this sort of form that they take. So things like interviews are good for uncovering explicit knowledge, so things people really know, and then using observation, where we're watching people actually in their jobs and their processes, that allows us to get that level of knowledge. But to get into those deeper areas, that's when we're getting into processes of making, processes of dreaming, things that they call here generative sessions, but in other language are co-creative sessions or co-design. And we'll talk about a bit later, but this became part of the foundation through which we formed our application. And we also used, this is just an understanding of the design process. So this is one of the very many design diagrams that are out there, but talking about what they call the fuzzy front end. So sometimes within a industrial method, design can come at the end. You do learning, you do research, and at the end you try to create something out of that in response. But if we bring that methodology, the iterative approach of trying, making, testing, learning, remaking, and bring it right into the start, we can actually start to move from a focus on a specific problem to understanding a larger problem space, understanding the bigger picture of what we're looking at, starting to question how we can move into that space and alternative approaches that may have more beneficial effects. And like I say, I'll get into that a bit later. Just one other slide on the design process. On the left, it's describing a fairly traditional view, which sees, a user on the left, the you, that is providing insights that are uncovered by the researcher, and then those are then put forward to your design team to create a product. And what we were advocating for was a more generative approach where everyone is working together, where users are acknowledged as the experts of their own experience, but also where they're brought in to help to uncover some of that tacit latent knowledge to actually be brought into some of the design process and involved throughout. One other note about the process that we employed, we also focused on service design methods. This is a way of acknowledging that a lot of what we use to consider products are oftentimes actually services. They gain value when they're used. And I think of that often within the craft and handmade, in that people are not buying them simply as objects that exist. People are buying them because they were made by someone. And that whole process of where you're connecting with an object, whether it's in a gallery space or in a store or in a studio, it's connected to story, and that process that brought it along adds value. And that process of meeting the person or getting to experience that making process. And it also allows us to also take a step back and consider other ways of people getting involved in craft. So it's not necessarily just as an end consumer, but how do we start to create opportunities for more people to get involved in craft practices, to learn, like the Hebert Hot Shop, that I think that basket story that someone shared yesterday was so great about how they started to value a basket more from learning to make it. So how do we help people to have deeper connections to making and realize that everything in our world is made, because we so often just see it as products at the end. The other thing it does, though, is shift us from a siloed perspective. So thinking of the different teams within production, we have our product team, our marketing team, our sales team, our retail team, and sometimes those can get can get segregated, and especially within a craft world where someone is selling and someone else is making, you can start to see a real separation. And what service design does is it takes those silos and it flips it on its side, that's the right side, and it starts to respect that those are all points within a service. They're what they call touch points. They're points of interaction, they're points in which someone comes and starts to learn or interact with that end product. But they all exist and all have to be acknowledged, and we also have to understand how people move between those steps. How do you move from learning about a product or learning about an artist to then meeting them or finding their work? This was situated within a grant that we proposed to the Canada Council's Digital Strategy Fund. So that was I was brought in during the forming of this grant, and we took a design approach where, rather than writing the grant to start with, we set up design workshops, one in Saskatoon and one in Regina. And at the time, we were looking at this service being situated within arts organizations to support organizations and then filtering down and helping the artists and others in their communities. And so we set up two sessions, one with arts administrators in Regina, that's the one you see here, and one here in Saskatoon, asking them to think about the space of what was working for them and what wasn't. I think of this very similarly to the last couple days that have been happening at this conference. So starting with getting a broad overview for yourselves, the craft sector, for ourselves, the art sector more broadly within Saskatchewan, and then starting to dream together possible design areas and opportunities. What this provided us with was our real starting point, our real question that we asked, which was, like, how can we start to create better opportunities for connection and communication throughout the province? Because what we were hearing is that because we're so large and so spread out, this can lead to feelings of isolation and disconnection, especially for artists in smaller communities. And so how can, because the digital world is so good at creating opportunities to connect, I mean, it can be so bad as well, but it can offer a lot of support. How can we start to create some of those opportunities to support artists in those connections? Then we moved into our design phase. So we started to, I've got a little map up here of the different communities we've traveled to, but before we started doing that, support us in that cross-disciplinarity, we formed a project team with artists and curators at the university, but also with archaeologists, with those in human-computer interaction, computer science, those in the library sciences, to ensure that we were collaboratively working together, sharing knowledge and building together. And then we had, so that's the team that's overarching our project. And then we have our two student teams. So we have one who are sitting mostly over on this table, who are our user engagement team, and you'll get to meet them later. They're the ones that are going out into the communities with myself to meet community members, to learn about their needs, their desires, and then to bring these back to our development team, who are the ones that are out just past the walls here with our canoe, that are then looking at actually building technologies, building approaches in response. And this is all done in an iterative manner. We've gone to these communities twice already. We'll be going back a few more times throughout the next 3 years, which is our project term. Because one of the other things that I really gained when I started to learn about the design process was this notion of quick tests, quick iteration, because what we don't want to do is start going down a path and go down it so far that we become emotionally attached to it and then have a hard time changing if it isn't working. But so by going out repeatedly, we're able to go out to communities, get their feedback, change quickly in response before we've gone too far down that path, and make sure that they are involved throughout the process. And so we have traveled to 7 different communities now, everywhere from LaRonge, Little Pine First Nation, and North Battleford, to spaces further south like Yorkton, Regina, and Estevan. We have driven out twice to each of these communities. There's a couple that weren't able to host us the second time we'll be going back to, but we've been making every effort to get out there repeatedly. And we'll be, again, continuing on. And it's been really important to us, too, that we're traveling out to these communities rather than asking them to travel to us for a couple of reasons. First of all, it's a displacement of labor. So often we ask smaller communities to travel to us to do that work, even if it's paid and even if, you know, we're reimbursing for gas money. It's labor, it's time. But secondly, we're doing this because we want to acknowledge the value that's held in our land. and start to learn from that too. And part of the one of the ways that we can do that is actually by traveling to communities, because there's a different understanding of a community, their challenges. When we start to put ourselves in their shoes, travel out there, they're able to welcome us, and now we're the foreigners too. So it's been really great, and we've worked with arts organizations and artists in each community, and then built from their relationships out, because I don't necessarily, and neither does our project team, have relationships in each of these communities to start. But by going out and learning and working first with organizations, we're able to then work from those relationships and build further. And it took a lot of a conversation at the start to build trust and to build the trust that we would come out and this wouldn't just be something where we would just get knowledge and then parachute in, gain knowledge, and get out of the community. But then when we called and said, can we come back a second time, it was sort of like, yeah, sure, we'll book you in. And it's becoming easier and easier as the community see us returning, as they see us listening and responding to what they presented. So the format, and this is some of us working through this, the format that we used was to produce, we took out worksheets. So they asked four basic questions. The first one asked our community members to describe a time that they enjoyed being involved in the arts. The second, a time that they found challenging or didn't enjoy. And we left this in completely open to what they would like to respond. But then we had a series of follow-up questions that asked to probe deeper to understand the context around this interaction. Because the interaction itself is good to know, but what we wanted to know was a deeper understanding of why they enjoyed it. So for example, in one of our smaller communities, a man talked about a time that he got to tour a major European museum, like the Louvre or another. And he really enjoyed this because of how engaged the tour guide was and how well they explained the art that was there to him. But when we asked a series of follow-up questions, one of them was, who did you experience this with? And it got him to thinking that the reason he enjoyed it so much was that his daughter, who was 17 at the time, had been there with him, and he had gotten to share this with her. She's in her 20s now, she's moved out of home. So when we asked the third question, which was, could you describe a way, in an ideal situation, what would be different? It got him to thinking that he would like her by his side at every point, at every gallery. That's not possible anymore. But so it started to allow us to start to look forward into some possibilities for how we could start to design for things to be different. So this produced a few hundred sheets worth of information. The last couple questions that we asked were to around more pragmatically, what are some of the main challenges and what would be different if you could choose it? And then our project team set out and wrote every observation, every insight that was gained onto a post-it note. And we used a process that's called affinity diagramming, which is gathering these together based on similarities to start to understand some of the currents and conversations that are taking place, but also as a way of externalizing this knowledge, because otherwise it gets held within our project team, but it's hard to pass on to anyone else. So this is them putting those together. This is sort of the mess that started to become. And it really is a process. You do this, and then you put out new sheets, and then you do it again. And what we're doing, the blue notes are sort of the headers for small groupings, and the pink notes start to group those blue notes together as a way of starting to understand, like I say, some of these conversations. What we arrived at was a discussion around challenges of accessing art and naming three main challenges: time, distance, and money. And then a discussion, you can see, I'm just gonna scroll through these quickly, but you know, just the sheer volume of conversation around each of these. And then what we heard was a discussion around ways in which people were overcoming these challenges. And they talked about community, connection, collaboration. So ways of coming together to work together to support each other to overcome some of these issues. And then they described what they saw as the end goal, which was a personal experience with art. And what became really interesting was sometimes that discussion was described as a personal experience with an object, getting to see artwork in person, but sometimes it was described as personal experience with the artists or with others who were, like that man who shared it with his daughter, with others who were there at the galleries with them or sharing these experiences. But it was that personal experience that they were really, that really was meaningful to them. They also described, and so that became our primary focus, and we have some other areas that also, we that are in the back of our minds, but we had to narrow our design focus. But talk about information and the ways that we communicate, and talked about like the networks that they're forming. So the other thing, the other method for externalizing that we used was the process of developing personas. These are bringing together general views of an artist or of the community members starting to talk about some of their needs, desires. I just want to read out on each one. We just have a quote. This one was, time, money, and connection are the main barriers. I wish I had a personal Medici so I could just make art. So someone, that was communicated by, as you can sort of see, a woman, you know, a middle-aged, younger to middle-aged woman in one of our communities. Then this was one that we found really intriguing. I didn't start going to art galleries until my daughter was 7 because she was interested in art. My friends would have made fun of me. She gave me permission to go. So it was, especially in some smaller communities, there was a real social barrier that started to emerge. And so we started to ask, how can we start to create, how can we start to design so people can have a feeling that they're welcome, have some knowledge of what they're seeing beforehand so they're not just going into something blind. Because someone else also said to us, they don't go to galleries because they're worried someone's going to ask them a question about the art and they'll be embarrassed because they don't know how to answer. And which is not something that often us within the art world feel, and so it was really great to hear that externally. Then we had someone sort of based on some of our project, our students on the project even, that said, Saskatoon's art community is so tight-knit that everyone in it has been in it forever, but those on the periphery of it don't know who to know. So is this discussion of how do you start to get involved in these networks? 2 minutes? Thanks. Then we have Violet, who's looking at another sort of experience of someone who is in the LGBTQ two-spirit community. I wish there was a venue where we could hold shows for our friends. And finally, Stephanie, one of our members from Little Pine First Nation, who said, we want art to come to our community. We don't want to have to leave our community to access art. So this became, again, a real focus for us, that notion that became so valid. And I think as I was speaking about a bit yesterday, we started to view that there wasn't, especially in smaller communities, a division between artist and viewer, but that people existed on a spectrum between those two. And that just as we have access to art in our communities, people in smaller communities wanted more access. So we held what we called a Hackfest, which was just a coming together, and this is where the making process came into it. That process of making and creating and gathering together, we had about 15 students broken into 5 teams, and they started to brainstorm around this. And one of these ideas became about how do we take art? And they started talking about like an art truck that could drive art around. But this became, although that's a lovely idea, it becomes really hard to get to everyone. And so we started to talk about how could we, I'm gonna just go through a few slides. That's our Hackfest, and a few slides here of our people in the Hackfest, all this brainstorming, prototyping, and then what we came out to was this idea of actually bringing art to communities through 3D scans, through augmented reality. And then this is some of the tests that we did on those ends. That's a sculpture scanned in my hotel room in Regina as we were testing out these techs. We've gotten better since then. That's a little cup, this idea that you could actually like sort of almost hold an object even though you're not at that object. So not ever trying to replace the personal experience of art, but asking, how could we start to create a better version of that? So after these talks and after our panel discussion, we have, and I'll stop here, but we have outside a canoe set up that you'll get to see through augmented reality. We have both the real canoe and the augmented reality version. And then that's one of the areas that we were starting to look at was how do we start to bring art to communities, or how do we also then in a reciprocal process bring the art of communities across the province as well to create more access for artists. So how do we get artists' work shared, but also for those who want to view art, how do we bring it to them? And then the second part is how do we start to create more context and conversation around art? And so Ruth Cuthand, who will be doing an object story, we've created a couple proof of concept augmented reality pieces that bring more context to our work. And then we're just starting to do work with youth as well. That part is going to be really more creative and learning through the process of making, but getting youth engaged in making augmented reality or video pieces and learning from them. I'll stop there. So thanks.